between them, that represents pitch, okay? So notice that that starts at one point on the thread to the right and goes to the same point in the thread to the left. That value is pitch. That is equal to 1 divided by threads per inch. And that's down here in the verbiage, okay? The distance between a point on an individual thread and the corresponding point on the next thread. Okay, the relationship of pitch and the number of threads per inch is simply pitch is equal to 1 divided by TPI, threads per inch. Okay, let's go over here on L and read the definition of lead. The distance the thread advances for one revolution of the threaded assembly. Okay? Lead equals pitch times number of starts. Okay? On a single start thread, the lead and pitch are equal or synonymous. Multiple starts. What's the program we're going to run? We're now going to start working on cutting a 3-start, 5-thread to the inch. Okay? The pitch is the same as for a 15-thread to the inch thread, because we have 3 times 5 or 15 threads in an inch. Okay? We just have 3 5 TPI threads laid side by side, equally spaced around this circle, each one starting 120 degrees away from the other. Okay? So the advantage of the multiple start being then we have a radical difference in the lead or in the distance that the threaded assembly travels in a revolution as opposed to with the single start. Single start, that is strictly the pitch. In the case of what we've been cutting, one revolution advances the thread assembly just slightly over 1/16 of an inch, 67,000. Okay. Calculate the pitch for 5 start, for 5 threads per inch is 1 divided by 5 or half, or thousandths. So in one revolution, that threaded assembly is going to travel 200 thousandths as opposed to just a 1/16 of an inch. Okay? What it boils down to is for the same length of engagement, you can engage and disengage a 3-start 5 thread in 1/3 the revolution that it takes to do the 15 thread for a single start. The thread depth is the same because we've laid 3 5 threads together, and that's the other beauty of it. If you took a single start thread and just cut a coarser thread, you increase the pitch, which makes it more favorable for speeding up the threading action. However, you also radically start building thread depth. Compare the required material for a 5 thread to the inch of 123,000 thread depth to the 15 to 41. It takes approximately 5 times more material in depth alone to be able to place a 5 thread per inch thread on the part. So if you're wanting to make nice little delicate boxes, you're not going to do that with a real coarse thread. Okay, the 5 thread per inch has the 200,000th lead. So that's beautiful. You can get it off and on in a third of a revolution by stacking 3 of them together. Well, you've got some advantage, some disadvantage. You merge the two together, you get the best of both stations. We get the high speed lead, which eliminates the constant turning to get a threaded part together. And we also then go back to the relatively shallow thread depth, so we don't have to make big clumsy boxes. You can make nice, delicate, slender boxes. So most of the terminology remains about the same. Now, by doing this on our lathe, we're going to place some limitations as far as the use of the threading chart. Let's go to plate number 3. Now, the easiest way for us to do the multiple starts is to put the 144 tooth gear on the mandrel. We've got a dividing plate built right into it. Okay, we used it in spiraling, we're going to use it in reciprocation too. Okay, so that takes then this whole threading chart and narrows it down to this first column. The first column shows across the top where it says the 144 tooth gear goes on the mandrel. Okay, so now that limits you from, if you were to cut single start threads with that 144 tooth gear, you can go from slightly over 1 inch thread per inch to about 8 1/3 thread per inch. But now start multiplying those by 3, 4, 6, 8, 10. How many starts do you want to make? That one little box has 8 starts. It's 2.5 threads to the inch, 8 starts, that's 20 basically a 25th ring.
Part.
Makes it look nice and delicate. It's got high speed leak. I mean, real quickly, quick off. Okay, so while it limits us to this column, it doesn't limit us to what we can do throughout. We still have a lot of latitude. I've got 48 hole pattern, the largest pattern on the whole 44 feet gear. You want to try 48 starts?
How can you keep it 48 starts hole?
You can get it to do it that delicately.
It would be equally divided because of this, your indexing equally.
Right. It would be as average.
I was trying to divide 44 into these.
No, what you do is you take those number of holes and multiply it times that. Take 8.33 times 48, and that's how many threads per inch we would cut if we attempted a 48 start. I mean, it's down to it's more like a burr, like a.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not real practical. The 5.15, for the purpose of this program, it's just nice. You know, it's numbers is three times, third as fast, third, three times faster, third as slow. That's how you want to look at it. So what we'll do now is we'll set up and we'll duplicate the first program. We'll turn a 2-inch male piece and then put a 3-start 5-thread on, which is going to look just like at 50 PPI as far as the thread depth and the portions of the thread. And then we'll make a mating part to it. There's a sample of one of these is floating around here somewhere. Where I've already done that restart. 3-start 5, yeah. I mean, one of those little samples we passed around has got that already. Those of you that want to look at it in advance, handle that again. That also then necessitates a complete gear change. So we just as well strip the gear train clear down. We're going to go back to turning with the V-belt drive. We want the gears off of it anyway. We're going to have to establish a new gear train. What is the gear train required for the 5 thread per inch on that first column with 144 on the mandrel?
72
on the lead screw. Go back and stay. All that replaces the mandrel and the idler gears. Obviously, we'll have to play with some different idler gears since we're putting that big gear back on the mandrel. I don't think I have enough room to run the 122 gear against it. Somewhere in my text, I've laid out there what I did this example with. What were the idler gears we selected on that? You can read through the text there, Bill. What fits in real well there.
Something happened to our sound.
Pardon?
Something happened to our sound here.
Sorry about that. You're really intense here and I stopped talking here once in a while.
What are we doing? Trouble? I'm not following your equation here. When it gets down to pitch, it says pitch equals 1 divided by threads per inch or 1 divided by 15.
Yeah, for 15 threads per inch, single start thread.
Single start thread. Okay, and that equals 0.0.
106. Yeah, 106.
Right. And then it says, and 1/5 equals 200.
Yeah.
Or 1 divided by 5 equals.
Yeah, 1 divided by 5, or the pitch for a 5-thread single start is 200,000.
It's 200,000.
As opposed to the 67,000. Just kind of a comparison to give you an idea how.
Okay, it's just a comparison.
Right. Okay. Just to show you the radical difference in the amount of material required. Both in the thread depth and how much faster the one thread moves than the other, or the threaded parts that we're in.
Okay, I understand.
And then the definition of, in the lead, it said the lead was equal to pitch times the number of starts. I think I arrived at that point a little differently. What it boils down to is the thread per inch times the number of starts. So you're cutting a 15 thread per inch. It's going to appear to be a 15 thread per inch thread because we've got five threads three times.
Three times, okay.
All right, so you can't go more. Not much advantage to go just two as opposed to the three from what little I played with it up here in my example. So didn't get that much benefit out of just a double start. Not like you left on three with a double start. I think you're back here on
chairs. Okay,
thank you.
Sure.
It's 1-573-194.
It's right there on your sheet.
Where?
It's the next to the last column. The KVC number 1573. And then for the model number, it's a...
KVC number 1573.
Right.
Yeah. All right, thanks, Your Honor.
Okay.
That's pretty small writing.
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to...
So you did.
Yeah, I knew you did. You're right here right now.
Okay, so I've turned the two-inch diameter spud again since the program we worked up was for a two-inch diameter thread. Got the spud turned. Time to change back to the threading tool. While I'm working on the tool post end, then I'll just go ahead and get all this set up. I'm not at the length of the point. The reason you're setting a thing on that 30-degree angle roughly is to wall that hole out wider and skim. For threading purposes? No. That's why I refer to as angular end feed. Instead of plunging the tool straight in and having chips coming off of both flanks of that V form, you're working on it radically increases the tool pressure. And our types of materials, that would increase the risk of chipping and breaking away. Would just be actually cutting on one side over. Okay. Why would you surface contact?
Why'd you pick 30? Because you just want to get past 60?
It's half of the total thread.
I could achieve the same thing if I picked 35, couldn't I?
No, because you would form the other side of the thread.
Okay, I'd gouge in.
Okay.
You got a little less than 30.
Yeah, actually, I'm going to approximately 29 and a half.
Makes a cleaner cut at 29 and a half.
Well, it keeps the tool point from dragging on the offhand side of the thread at all. Okay. Because the tool has the same thread form as what you're cutting. If you go right at the 30 and travel down that angle, it helps. It wraps around the point of the tool and drags on it here as you cut it. For us, it probably doesn't make that much difference for cutting wood. You know, a metal tournament does make some difference, but I don't know how much difference it make here. But like I say, it's just a threading practice that I've developed over the years.
And you have turned back to a specific size?
Yeah, we're back to 2 inch. We're running the basic 2 inch diameter again. So I've got to turn back to 2 inch, set my compound to 29 and a half, and I'll take the cross side into the stop. Now, once again, I didn't take the time to face off the end, so the only surface I've got to work with is true is going to be this return, the major diameter. This face out here was made with a series of steps, so I don't guarantee it being true. This is good. It gives you ways and varieties of ways to use this centering gauge. So now I position the centering gauge so that I can come inside the one groove and lock through the centering gauge. I'm using my reference marks up here, and then, you know, they come in real close, but for the exercise, I'll go through a demonstration of how to use your centering gauge, because you will need to do that. Or, do as I did, if you face that off, then you can take the square and run across the side of your tool. This is a control ground tool. Hand ground ones, again, like I said, it's going to be a different story. You make your own tool, you may have to do some fudging on that. All right, so let's go in now. We've got the cross slide back against the template rack for a backstop. The dollar compound leaf screen in contact. We're at 5,000.
Are you contacting it on the flat surface or the chamfer?
On the flat surface, on the major diameter. Okay, gear train. Multiple starts. We said we're going to use 144 tooth gear on a mandrel, so we had the index capability built into it. We're going to 3-start. There are 3 different hole patterns we could use. I'm a real simple person. 30 divided by 3 is 10, so I'm going to go to the 30 hole pattern.
So much force to turn it.
Pardon. Oh, thank you very much. Right. Now, if you can, if you're running on this ratio, where you've always got this nice big gear here, everything else is guaranteed to be smaller driving into it, and you've got the mechanical advantage. There's a world of difference in the effort that's required right now as opposed to what was required on that other gear train. Okay, now, it should be, oh boy. We'll have to go back through and touch off again here.
Or we were playing rules.
Yeah. You weren't paying attention. We had already gone through the test out, hadn't we? It's all right. It doesn't take just a moment. We go back through here, wind up close to the bar. Usually I do that with the gear train disengaged so I can just move the carriage and you don't have everything flopping and turning. It takes less effort to turn it. And we'll go back through it. And what I'm doing is just slowly advancing the compound lead screw, rotating the tool until I feel the tool strike the part. Then I take note of my dial reading. Okay, before I said it was the 5,000, and I came back to 4,000 that time. We'll stay with the 5. Okay, we had calculated earlier what the thread depth was for an external thread, 15 threads to the end, right? On the multiple start, it was 41 thousandths, and we needed to scrabble 47 thousandths on the compound. Okay, we're actually cutting a thread with the lead of a 5 thread per inch or an advancement of 200 thousandths per revolution, but because we're putting 3 of those 5 thread per inch threads on this piece, we're able to duplicate the thread depth to the 15. The formula for thread depth deals with pitch. In this case, for multiple starts, the pitch is 3 times thread per inch. Okay, 1 divided by 3 times the thread per inch. So it's still 1 divided by 15. It comes out the exact same thread depth. That's the beauty of multiple starts. You put work in increments like that, you get back to that shallow thread depth, but you have that high spiral lead. So we'll be able to reuse all of the numbers that we calculated in the earlier program for 15. We'll just reuse them right here. Same way we're going to go to the internal thread. The bore size is going to be the same thread depth there. So, you know, that's one of the beauties of it. Okay, so we have 41 thousandths external thread depth. We're going to be going 47 thousandths on the compound dial since we're traveling it, traversing it on the 29 and a half, basically a 30 degree angle. As opposed to it, it's going to start out at 10 thousandths. Make sure everything ought to be. Now, is that camera going to show nothing is really showing the thread apart, is it? Okay, what you need to do now is one at a time, come take a walk up here before I go too much further. Take a look at what this thread looks like. Notice how wide the gap is between each of the threads, between each revolution of the thread. Okay. I'm slowly going to work myself down to that 41,000 thread depth. That big white space between the spirals. That'll improve a little bit by the fact that I'm going in greater depth, but it won't improve that much until I put the other threads on there and fill that gap in. When we go to the next pass and you watch that next track, it's get laid right in on top of the other one. Depending on where I index, it's either going to come out here and work into that one or start right on top of it or work away from it. You know, I said that clear up will be dependent on how I go about index, which direction I roll the car.
Okay, we got the main one over there.
I'm just eyeballing so that my tool doesn't hit the shoulder and then I set my zero. Let's stop it back here on the back of the tip of the rack. When I adjusted the leaster here to pick the part up, I did it with the cross by jammed against the fixed rack.
Did I see you pump that so that that's not the answer?
I've got a light rag on it right now. I'm driving that along the county off here. Now, once I reach that final depth, at 47,000, then I'll snug that a little more. Now, on the next two threads, I'll start out at the 5,000th mark at the Halloween 10 pin. Lock the fuel post in position with the tension out there and slowly work my way back to that solid stop. Okay? Rather than indexing for every cut depth pass, I'll take this thread to depth for this multiple passes, then I'll index, stay out away, and work my way back to that final depth with the the next trail. Okay, that should put the pretty much the final depth of a blocker stop here. Training practice is to take a free pass. So I'm at my final depth, so I'm going to take a free pass now.
You're not going to go any deeper than that?
No, that's it. That's the 47,000 feet. Here. Okay. Now, if all I was cutting was a single start fire thread to the inch, I'd be going in until that came to a point. Well, I'm going to fill that gap in with two more threads of that depth. My motor starts. So now I come back here and I make my 10 hole index. I said, I'm all right, I cheated, I locked this out. Roll around, I picked that 10 hole up. That's 10 holes, so one third of the revolution. Okay, I'll zip right out about here for the first pass. We just work our way back to that depth stop again now. See how it's starting almost right on top of that first thread? It's going to travel away from that. The end pin angle is going to travel down that way, so that will slowly get lighter in that direction. This is the part I like to watch. It's very great in there. Now 20 holes from where I started. I counted 10 more holes.
All right.
Now, when this thread, and if they're done in this thread, will it fill in the gaps? And if you took a 15 thread per inch thread gauge and laid it on there, it would line up, it would match in. I've got one of these, just kind of demonstrate. See where it's starting here, Ray? Right on top of this one, it's moving that way, so it's going to cut out this gap here. If it goes in there, it'll cut. It'd be nice to get it. Yeah, yeah, it's moving down.
Gee, I was a director for a second.
I'm getting slow and real deep.
Then it would be the gap between them that would narrow, you know, get wider both directions at the same time. Rate of leads, you don't need that real long spigot anymore. You can get by with a shorter biggest, you've got three threads on there instead of just one, so it's, you know, three times the gripping strength or the, you know, resistance to shear that you have with just the one. We'll take that out now. At this point then, we're ready to go back to the, set the machine back up for turning. We'll bore the mating part out so we can cut the internal thread, and we'll go back and thread it. Now, as you pass this around and look at it, you look right at the end in this lead chamfer that I put on there, you'll see the three distinct starting points of that thread. And, you know, I think most of you are able to get up around here while it was running. You could see that when I cut that first thread, I left a wide land. The only way I could have filled that in would have been to keep going on cut depth till I brought the V form to a point, as in the case of single start, or in this case, I just filled that in with two more threads, indexing it through the plate and incremental. This is a 1/3 of a revolution. Four start would be a 4th revolution. You know, multiplication right on that. Okay? Well, let's change over real quick from thread cutting back to turning. We're going to use the same gear train, so once again, I'm going to disassemble only what I need to on it. Let's get the big one. It's an automatic to get the 144 tooth gear off, so let's get it off the mandrel. The other two idler gears aren't going to bother me for turning, so I can leave them on there and just pivot the quadrant plate out of the way to where it disengages with the lead screw. And that way, as I turn the lead screw, I'm not driving the spindle anymore, so that could be better. That it takes all of the vibration out of the assemblies, Alan.
You go down the back stairs and you'll see it says men.
If you don't put enough on, then you'll get a certain amount of rumble and bounce out of the motor here against your flexion.
Yeah.
All V belts have lumpy lumps in them. You know, where they bond them together, turns a corner here on this one, all over that way. Standard operating procedure for V belts in the molding process. So as that goes through the pulleys, that creates a vibration.
Mine sort of screeches when it starts. Is that because I've got it too tight or not tight enough?
No, more than likely, that probably is not a belt screech, I would think it would be. What you might be facing is, and I've had problems with that, you notice on this blade, on this pulley, I had a second set screw trying to keep the aluminum pulleys tight in the motor shaft. Screeching, and especially if you have a real bad rattling sound, rattle, you know, just the brief. Momentary rumble rattle. Could be that these pulleys are wobbling on the, you know, not enough to see it, but it's enough to hear. Set screw for the overhead drive pulley is at an angle in here.
Yes.
The fact that it's an angle reduces its effectiveness.
Yeah.
Okay, so it tends to, you're not locking with the cut point of the set screw like it was designed more inside of it. But I've also had this one loosen up on the too. So you might check those when you get home. Everything's down the range. Drop them in here and keep them snug. From time to time, you'll want to look at that. If you have trouble with it continually loosening up, you may want to try and find some nylock set screw. That little nylon insert embedded in the thread that acts as a vibration damper to help prevent the vibration from loosening the thread. Okay, we're turning on. Okay, we're turning. So we want to get rid of the barrel spin. Go back to the turning train on. Try to take that the other way. Okay, if I recall, the other program, four side, 15 TPI, came out with one is 928, wasn't it? This, you know, the program I worked up here by doing 3 start 5, which is just a multiple of 15, it makes it nice because all of those numbers that we calculated the first time around work again for our thread depth and work rate. We don't have to go through a lot of calculations. Not that it's, you know, there are not difficult calculations. The formulas are going to make it real quick. Very easy to come up with those numbers. It's supposed to be off. Thank you. we'll get it deep enough that we get at least a revolution out of that assembly. Cut depth on this if I wasn't too lazy to change that tool, but I have to have that tool in there. I'll just use this. With a different form tool, like that pointed tool you've got, Bill, you know, you can just really rip and tear on in this way. Even a full radius tool gives you a speed this process up, you got a little better cut geometry or something like that. This makes it quick. We use the same tool. I don't have to spend a lot of time changing tools. Okay, we're after 1 inch 928. You also notice I didn't take the time to turn the compound back square. We can use my chronometer dial on it. Remember, we had to go further at that angle to achieve the 41,000. So if I use my chronometer screw and turn in 100 thousandths, I won't get the full 200 on diameter, but it'll be so much better.
Makes it look easy. He's done it so much. I find I have to write out on a big piece of paper every step and every dimension.
Well, Alan, there are days when I would be wise if I had done that too, believe me.
Look, maybe the guys have got one.
Yeah.
Sure is leaning out.
Yeah. As long as it doesn't snow.
Yeah.
If I had turned the compound back around square, this would have been more accurate and more rapid. Okay, we're at 935, so we're using some of the tolerance that I said we could build into our threads here. The 1 inch 928 would have been nominal. But we're almost, we're what, 7,000 larger. That'll come in handy. Okay, let's convert ourselves back to thread cutting now. We'll put a lead chamfer on that chisel. Let's do that real quick. That's nice. Nice half of the end to get rid of that sharp ragged start trim real quick. Get rid of the bolt for this and throw a chamfer on it. This time I'll take a moment while I'm doing that and go ahead and face the front of that so it'll make it a little easier to line the threading tool up. Okay, I'm going to be back on this side. The other way. You fall error, you fall chance to that error at home too. I have to really watch myself in these demonstrations because I do. I get to trying to, to go quick and I get to talking and then, when my mouth runs, my brain shuts down. And it's easy to forget that. So you just need to develop a work habit of always, when you're through turning, disconnect the V-belt before you do anything else to eliminate that risk. And that is a definite risk. Okay. Got a choice of starting either the gear train or the tool post. Let's go up the tool post end of it first again. Rear these chips. Go back and put the drilling spindle in with the threading tool and align it so the tool geometry is perpendicular to the work piece. Now, since I was wise enough to face the front of this part, we can set the center gauge right back on the front of the part. Get some background in here. Set it against a nice wide surface that way. Visually align it. Close enough. Okay, while we're at this point, we'll just as well pick up the located surface of the part here. How am I doing on time, folks? I'm running out already.
Time's like
less than half.
You get those 7 o'clock times anymore, it's just slides.
Pardon me? Oh, yeah.
What kind of slides are we going to work
tonight? Ray has a bunch of slides on to do with ornamental turning shows, some of the old equipment, old machines, some of the work that Frank Knox did and a couple of the other people. I think the whole program was written on that about half an hour here.
Half hour, 45 minutes.
Gives you some of the history, right? And I'll let you tell them what's done. It's your program.
Well, I did this program down in Texas at the AW meeting. And if you were there, you've already seen it. But it's some slides of work that people have done, mainly Frank Knox and a couple of others. Some slides of his equipment and some other ornamental equipment. And just quick little rundown on some of the history of ornamental turning and machines, who made the machines, a timeline on the Old Sapple family, what they did back in the year. Did anybody bring any slides for shows or their work or anything? Anybody bring slides? When we get back from dinner, do the slides, or we can knock on them, or just if you want to visit and talk to the panel and the team, you know, we're pretty much open for that, whatever you guys want to do.
Okay. Set back up for threading. Back on the zero hole and 30 hole pattern with the 144 tooth gear on the mandrel, index the quadrant plate back up to engage the lead screw with the gear tray, so we're moving on that pit again. We've set a zero point here. In this case, we're starting out at the 70 thousandths mark, and we said we were going for a cut depth of 42 thousandths on the angular end feed, right? I have to do some arithmetic again. So we should travel to 112 thousandths, or in this case, 100 thousandths dial, and we'll go to the 12 thousandths mark on the next revolution. Go through the same process that we did with the external thread. We've got cross side against the stop, give ourselves some cut depth here. Now I like to start with about 10,000. Nothing magic about that number. I like nice round numbers. I'm threading into a blind pocket, and since I'm using the angular infield, I'm going to stay back a little bit this first thread, a little further, because every successive pass, I'm going to come closer to that bottom. Just as Bonnie was saying, this is the place to put the thread release through, and you just drop your tool right in it. And that eliminates that concern.
See down at the bottom?
Pardon?
At the bottom of the front there.
I'll put it right.
You put it where, Bonnie?
At the beginning.
This doesn't have to put it in the lift.
Just a little lift to go over there.
Just got to get going inside.
Okay. Well, a couple of little samples that were passed around, I put a thread release groove on the inside where I let the fuel just pass in the air. And so you don't have to do it that way. That's the way I did. On that the little threaded box over here that I did on the Rose engine, and when I did the Rose engine work,
I dropped that radius tool in behind that, actually undercut behind the treads with that. Thermal effects that are possible for you there. Stop shallow on these internal threads, and then in this case, we'll cut all three of them just a little bit shy of the mark, and then we'll go through the fitting process. So this will be the final pass on the first thread. So good practice dictates a free pass. Just go right back through it. Just gonna need a deflection and the tool apart in your setup. Index cam holes, going through the three stars, we're in the 30 hole pattern, index cam holes. All right, we started out at the 70 thousandths mark, we now have our depth stop set, so let's back out. I like to take 10 on the first time, so we'll set it 80, lock the compound down with the thumb screw lock. You're going to see in the bottom of this one where I'm overrunning the bottom end of that pass a little bit and gouging the floor. That's partly due to that extremely large shape I've got on this particular tool. And partly because I get busy talking and don't see the one coming out. Final pass on this thread. Notice I've cut the number of passes down a little bit. It's getting close to dinner time. The time it starts gnawing on the backbone, you do things quicker. Give it its free pass. Make the final index. And once again, I'm going to, after I've made this final index, I'll go back over the first two with the compound locked down in position so that basically I've removed another variable. I know that all three threads then are finished at that same compound setting or same tool setting, okay?
Snug yet. All right, let's, what time we got?
Oh, we're good shape.
In 15 minutes, I can make three passes in 15 minutes either. Let's dial in about 3,000 here.
An inch and a half.
Make the hell sure. Thing for us, do it.
Boy, you can tell when it gets to the dinner time, the crew gets rowdy.
That wood gets tougher and less apt to chip at any time.
Yeah.
You're like a hollow factory now. No bother gets made on Monday or Friday. Still pretty tight thread.
Well, we knew that.
But we're turning close to all the thread, aren't we? Okay, so anyway, there's your three start. Five threads to the inch. By doing a three start, it yields to the same pitch as a 15 thread to the inch single start, but it has the lead of a five thread single start. So revolution of the threaded mechanism, this cap advances 200 thousandths as opposed to 67 thousandths on it. A lot of potential there for your decorative boxes. Like I said, you can expand that. I've got the one little box and the sample at 8 starts. We'll go 48, about 48 holes there. And that wouldn't be too out of line with a one pit, you know, one thread to the end. That'd be 48 threads. That's not a real bad thread. It would be fortunate enough to be able to support it if it was in the right material. Yep. Yeah, it would. Okay, so let's field a few questions on the multiple start threads, and then I guess we're going to worship and go get something to eat.
Yeah.
Okay, everybody got a good grasp of what we went through?
You chamfered that it was some dimension before it has to be.
The chamfer, in order to be there when you're through cutting the thread, needs to be larger than the thread depth. Okay. I like to use a 45 degree chamfer on my starts. If you match the chamfer to the angle of the thread, 30 degrees, then in all practical intent and purpose, there is no chamfer there at that start thread. So run a different angle chamfer. I like 45. And you need to have a larger chamfer than thread depth, otherwise, especially with these multiple starts, since we start at three distinct points or four points, then there's less chamfer available after you're through cutting thread if all you do is match the cut depth.
So part of the purpose. Thread depth was what, 41?
41 thousandths.
You're going to make it bigger than that?
Yeah.
How much bigger than that?
It doesn't make a difference. It's up to you. If you make it enough larger, then it helps funnel the two parts together. Okay. If you only make it a few thousandths larger, then sometimes it's more difficult to start the two threads. Make it a little larger, it acts kind of a funnel to draw the two together. Okay. Part of the purpose of the lead-in chamfer. Another trick on that, and I don't know if one of these pieces around here has another trick on that would be in front of the thread on the mail, on the external thread, turn a pilot that would clear the minor diameter of the female thread. That drops the two together a little bit, helps the alignment. I may have a sample around here that I've done that on. A lot of the restrictions on that would be depending on the design of your piece. You can't afford to give too much material to the thread, because then if you tend to start making your boxes somewhat cumbersome. And part of the reason we like the multiple start thread is to eliminate the massive material required for the high lead thread. We can make nice, delicate looking work basis, so you have to be careful you don't put that stop back somewhere else trying to make other little things look easy alignment stuff like that. There is some lies to that. Bonnie's real good at designing boxes. She can give you some real nice points. She's got some beautiful work in there. I'm basically done with thread cutting unless someone has any more questions. Y'all be ready to go home.